بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم. Welcome to whatever number in the series of discovering Islam. We have started talking about the basic expectations of the Almighty from the believer in the practical life. And we started with ibadat. And when we talk about ibadat, the first thing that we discuss is salat. And that is followed by zakat. So we have had two sessions each on salat and zakat. And the third tenet of Islam is saum, fasting. So we will talk about fasting because fasting has got all to do with Ramadan. So there might actually be some discussion on Ramadan as well. It is normally that we find this particular verse recited over and over again. Well, either at the beginning, at the time when the month, holy month of Ramadan is about to arrive, or during the month of Ramadan. It's not a bad idea to recite it sometimes, even otherwise, when Ramadan is at some distance from us. It is Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 183. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, believers, kutiba alaykumus siyam. Fasting is made binding on you, obligatory on you. Kama kutiba ala ladhina min qablikum. The same way as it was made binding on those who came before you. La'allakum tattaqun. So that you may become muttaqi. You know, it is the brilliance of the presentation of the Quran. You find sometimes, well, many times, verses which are brief, but they are loaded with information and guidance. So the first thing is that the Almighty makes it binding on us to fast. The interesting thing is that when you look at this verse and this passage in its context, the Almighty in Surah Al-Baqarah began by addressing believers. And the very first thing that was mentioned was the expectation to know and to adopt one's attitude towards life in accordance with the understanding of Tawheed, the unity and oneness of Allah. And then there were a few matters that were discussed that had something to do with the immediate environment, followed by a brief mention of the entire religion of Islam in one verse, which is verse 177. Laysal birra an tuwallu wujuhakum, start from there. So that is the beginning point of the long description of Sharia that we find in Surah Al-Baqarah. The first thing that you find therein is the mention of the Almighty's guidance regarding what needs to be done in regard to sanctity of life, followed by sanctity of wealth. So the law of Qisas is mentioned, and then the need to write will before a person dies is emphasized. And then it's going to be followed by a mention of Hajj. And on that particular occasion, when the verses were being revealed, there was a need for jihad and so on. In the middle of it comes the mention of fasting during the month of Ramadan. Now, the question arises, why? Some people might ask me, why are you asking why? Just read the Quran, understand it, know the translation, and keep going. No, that's not the right attitude, not the right approach. Why? Because the Almighty himself asks us to ponder and reflect deeply on the verses of the Quran. So we have to understand the Quran as best as we can, and we need to reflect and ponder over its verses over and over again. A, that's one reason. The other reason is when you know that this book of Allah, which has been preserved for all times to come, was not sequenced, marshaled in the way that it is now when it was revealed. Its sequence of revelation is different. Chronological order was different. And it has now been substantially, you know, changed later on by the Prophet ﷺ himself. And there has to be a reason why it has been redone. And therefore, it's extremely important that we understand it. Well, the basic idea that seems to emerge is that when you are to follow the Sharia of the Almighty, the law of the Almighty, how would you do it? I mean, okay, if you're a part of a Muslim society, you'll pray, in comes Ramadan, you will fast, you know, you'll start giving zakat, etc. But that's not what is the real expectation of the Almighty. There are some people who have come up with another way of following the Islamic law and Sharia. I don't say it's wrong, but it is secondary. It is something in addition and should not be the real way an individual, a believer, should be motivated to follow Islam. And that way is that you start mentioning the rewards, sawab of good deeds, and people get motivated. You say your prayer, you get this much of sawab. You say you give your zakat, and you will be to be rewarded handsomely, and so on. I'm not too sure how you can get motivated on a regular basis over a period of time. You do sometimes need these assurances and reassurances. I do agree. And I'm sure that the Prophet ﷺ, if he mentioned them, there is a reason for it. But I think the more important thing is the basic spirit. And that spirit is taqwa. So the Almighty is therefore mentioning right in the middle of, not exactly the middle of, at some point after the description of some aspects of Islamic Sharia, and then later on to be followed by other aspects of Islamic Sharia, the Almighty mentions fasting for the purpose of having taqwa, so that when you are following the Almighty's Sharia, you know what the right spirit should be. So that's where, you know, this passage actually comes from. That is why it has been positioned at that particular part of Surah Al-Baqarah. Now, the next question is, what is taqwa? I think a very good translation in English that is done is God consciousness. I think it captures the spirit of it. That is, you live your life with an understanding, realization that your God is present. He knows what you're doing. And you're going to be accountable to it. It's a feeling. It's a realization. It comes, it goes. It needs to stay for as long a time as is possible. And it's something that needs to be worked on to be able to get created and cultivated and to remain with us. When we will have that realization, most certainly it will have an impact on our behavior, on our conduct. So that aspect is also called taqwa. So a muttaqi person is the one who is God conscious as far as the spirit is concerned and is following the expectations of the Almighty as a consequence, because he knows the Almighty is present. He knows that the Almighty is looking at him, and he also knows that he's going to be held accountable to him. And therefore, I must behave in a way that is befitting, that is in line with this understanding of mine. Okay, that's one aspect of the understanding. Another aspect of the understanding of taqwa is what I would want to refer to. It's there in Surah Al-Ma'idah, and it's mentioned in a context wherein the Almighty has talked about the prohibition of of khamr, intoxicating drinks. It seems that when the Almighty has talked about it, there were people who felt that, you know, we have been drinking for quite a while. So, I mean, if it was something that was disliked by Allah, what's going to happen to us? I mean, it really has been after a very long while that the Almighty has expressed his clear displeasure towards those people who drink alcohol, who consume alcohol. So what about us? So to console them, to give them comfort, the Almighty says, لَيْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ جُنَاهُ. There is no blame on those people who believe and do good deeds. فِيمَا تَعِمُوا. In matters of what they have already consumed. But what has happened is happened. إِذَا مَتَّقَوْا. So long as they remain God conscious. وَآمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. And believe and do good deeds. And then they are God conscious. And they believe. And then they are God conscious. And they achieve excellence. And Allah, He loves those who are Muslim. It's a beautiful, it's a very deep, it's a very important verse. It mentions what has been clarified in a very, very famous hadith. And that is what that is what the relationship between Quran and hadith is. If you are able to figure out where a certain hadith is describing the Quran, you know, you would be able to understand the Quran better. But if there is no connection, then there are problems. So in a hadith, which is one of the most famous hadiths, called hadith Jibreel, when Jibreel alayhi salam came as a human being, in the form of a human being. And he asked the Prophet many questions. The first three questions were regarding Islam, Iman, and Ihsan. The three different levels of realization, of achievement, of a believer. So it seems that they are in the same sequence. It's first Islam, and then Iman, and then Ihsan. To begin with, a person is just a Muslim. And as the Quran tells us that if you're just a Muslim and you're doing good deeds, it's fine. If you are not a hypocrite, if you don't reject Allah's message and you're okay with it, but you don't actually believe. Belief is something different. I mean, belief is an understanding which makes you convinced and you have a deep realization. But that is also only one level, a second level. And the highest level is Ihsan. Which, according to another hadith, is sometimes to be found in one's devotion to the Almighty in a way. You worship Allah in a way as if you are looking at Him. Because even though you can't see Him, He does see you. So, when you worship the Almighty, or when you are operating in this life trying to be a good servant of the Almighty, you behave in a way as if you are looking at the Almighty, making sure that, you know, you're telling yourself that the Almighty is looking at you. So, you know, the behavior is going to be the very best. So that is the excellence that we need to achieve. What I'm trying to say is, that from the first step to the second, and the second step to the third, from Islam to Iman, and from Iman to Ihsan, the propelling push, the motivating factor is taqwa. So it's the spirit of taqwa, which is, if it's there in you, then even if you start from Islam, just obedience, you move on to Iman, and there's a possibility that you also go as high as Ihsan, which is obviously what the purpose is for every good Muslim to achieve. Okay, the next question. How does fasting inculcate taqwa? I can answer this question theoretically. Practically, I always struggle, and I invite your attention and your input to let me know, and let's find out how should we ensure that while we are fasting and we know that we are doing it for taqwa to be created, inculcated in us, but how does it happen? I think I must have mentioned it before sometime, that the same question comes to my mind. The same question doesn't come, alhamdulillah, in the case of prayers. Prayer is fine. I mean, I'm not saying many prayers which we say and we are unmindful. But we do sometimes remember Allah. But fasting as well as animal sacrifice. You know, in sacrifice, the Almighty wants us to make sure that when we are sacrificing an animal, we are actually mentioning to the Almighty through our conduct, showing the spirit that we are available. We are here to offer any sacrifice you are asking for from us. It's just that this particular animal sacrifice is symbolic, and through it we are just giving you this unconditional offer. I don't know, it should happen, but it doesn't happen, I must admit. And we must do something. I don't know what meditation, soul searching, discussion, or all three of them, to be able to have this spirit, you know, within us as a result of these two great expressions of worship, fasting and sacrifice. So fasting helps in creating taqwa, because when you are fasting from dawn to till dusk, you stay away from satisfying your basic needs for the sake of the Almighty. As in when you feel the need to have food, water, which is available, you don't do it. You don't consume it. Why? Because you're fasting. What does that mean? This is Allah's instructions. So I can't do it. That is what taqwa is. You have a feeling that Allah knows what you're doing. You're conscious of it. And then, despite the fact that there are temptations, inclinations for you to do wrong, you stop, you don't do it. And you do it for 29, 30 days running. There is a very strong reason to feel, to hope that this spirit is going to remain within you for the rest of your 11 months. Which, as I said, you know, is something that we need to worry about. How can we do it? It is possible. The Almighty tells us that that's why fasting has been prescribed as one important act of worship, but it's something which is missing. Okay. Then there are other virtues also, that if we fast properly, preparing ourselves mentally for this exercise, and are conscious of the fact that this exercise does offer us tremendous opportunities to become a better believer, servant of the Almighty. Probably one of the most significant attributes of a believer ought to be that he is thankful, grateful to me. And that is what fasting enables us to, or offers the opportunity to us to have within us. You are thankful to somebody because you realize that what you have been given by that person, that source, is really very important. You needed it. You needed it. You didn't deserve it. And you've given it to you. So when that realization is there, then there comes within your heart, your inner soul, this feeling. It's basically a feeling. You're really grateful. You know, the person or the source has been really kind. Obviously, when we realize that everything that we have with us in this life is from our Creator, And it ought to create the feeling of thankfulness, gratefulness to the Almighty. That is why you find in the Quran that the very beginning statement is gratefulness to the Almighty. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alamin. All praise, all expressions of gratitude are for Allah, who is the Lord, the creator and sustainer of the entire mankind. So it's primarily because we humans realize that whatever we have in this life has been given to us by our creator. We didn't deserve it. We needed everything that he has given us. We needed them badly. Now that he has given those blessings to us, he deserves to be thanked. The fact that this expression comes right at the beginning of the Quran is a testimony of the fact that God's message and religion is primarily based on a feeling of gratefulness. We want to be grateful to the Almighty, and therefore we seek his guidance to know what we ought to do to make him pleased. What is going to make him happy? And the answer is, it is my message. Follow it. So we follow it, not basically primarily out of a feeling of fear, not because of that we are fearful or scared. That truth is there. We are humans. It is primarily because we are grateful to him. Everything else follows.
Question: would it be categorized as
shukr? Okay.
Gratefulness.
You know, ihsan. The word does have shukr in it as a part of the package of that level, wherein you are doing it in a way that you always realize that the Almighty is there showering his blessings upon you, and therefore he deserves your attention focused towards him all the time. So that's right, that feeling does help in achieving the level of ihsan. They are all interrelated, and I think we need to continue to think and discuss these matters, because probably it's a lack of discussion on such matters that we lack the spirit. And it's only when we discuss and we feel the realization comes. So, shukr is another attribute that we are able to get the opportunity to inculcate. I mean, honestly, the attributes that are desired from a believer, they're not there for somebody to just get them accidentally, just by fluke. You have to work at them. And, you know, if you're conscious of the fact that you need to improve yourself, you can work upon yourself. You know, when we come to this world, we are raw. We are crude. We have the potential. We have the realization. But there are weaknesses, and we have to work upon them. So one can become more and more thankful. And fasting helps in enabling us to achieve it. How? Again, the same exercise. When we are deprived of the blessings of the Almighty for a good part of the day, and we need them desperately, we start realizing that, you know, they were important. Quite often, we are not thankful because you've got so many things. I mean, the needs are getting satisfied. There are no problems in life. So why would you be thankful? You know, so you need to be more conscious. You need to exert in order to tell yourself that we need to be, you know, we should be thankful. But sometimes when you realize that what you have is actually something you don't deserve, you didn't deserve. And this can happen at times when you are deprived of some of those blessings. You know, I probably have mentioned, but you know, this incident is so very effective in reminding us of the same reality. It probably is worth mentioning over and over again. Sheikh Saadi is reported to have said that, you know, when he was traveling towards the house of Allah, he had a routine of going to the house of Allah on foot. Obviously, there weren't any kind of transportation facilities that we have now. But he made it a routine. So in one of these journeys, and he was traveling towards the house of Allah on foot, his shoes, they were worn out. And he had to walk barefooted. And obviously, you know, there were difficulties. So he said that when I was walking without my shoes, I had this feeling within myself, this feeling of kind of ungratefulness. I was complaining to the Almighty, what's going on? I am walking towards your house and see what's happening to me. I don't even have shoes to walk with. And he said that very soon I entered a village where there was a masjid, and in the masjid when I entered, I saw a man who didn't have legs. Wow. And I immediately, spontaneously prostrated to the Almighty in gratefulness, telling him, oh Allah, I'm so grateful to you that I have feet to walk with. And I've been so ungrateful that I was complaining to you that I didn't have shoes. So it's true, you know, when you look at people who are less than you in worldly matters, in worldly blessings, you do realize how great those blessings are. Jesus Christ, Isa alayhi salam, was asked once, why did Allah make blind people? And he said he made blind people for those with eyes to see. Wow. So that people who've got eyes, they should see that there are blind people as well. You could also have been one of them. So, you know, this gratefulness is something which is another very important attribute which you can have as a result of your experience of fasting in Ramadan. And again, as I said, it's something that could only happen if we are conscious of the fact that this is something that we need to work on. The Quran tells us that while we are fasting in the month of Ramadan, we should be aware of the fact that the month of Ramadan is the month when the Quran was revealed. So it is therefore that the Almighty required us to fast. Now again, you know, you have to try to work it out. What is the relationship? You know, because we are not in the habit of thinking. And the Quran wants us to cultivate this attitude, approach. What is the relationship of one thing that is mentioned with the other? And the more you focus and the more you understand, the more you feel that the Almighty, whatever He says, has a lot of tremendous wisdom behind it. So, the Quran is a book of guidance. Verse 185, immediately after the first two verses of fasting, says, "Shahru Ramadan al-lazi yunzila fihi al-Quran." Month of Ramadan is the month in which the Quran was revealed. Well, it was enough for the Almighty to tell us that the Quran was revealed. But He didn't stop there. Because He knew that we needed to be reminded. You know what is the Quran? What Quran is? Hudal lin-nas. It's the guidance for mankind. It's the guidance for the entire mankind. What is guidance? Well, guidance is that this life is as I've been saying, is a puzzle. There are questions which remain unanswered. And it's only the Quran that tells us clearly and confidently that this is the path. Well, there are many other sources that also tell clearly, but not confidently. Because you can only have confidence when you are confident that the book is absolutely the same that was revealed to by the Almighty on His Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that source is only the Quran. But it doesn't stop there. The next part is وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِنَ الْهُدَىٰ. And this guidance is clear. Allah knew that there are going to be people, Muslims, who would say that the Quran is not clear. So we need to have other sources. So He mentioned it clearly. وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِنَ الْهُدَىٰ. It's a clear. There are clear signs of verses of guidance in the Quran. And he didn't stop there either. The third thing he mentioned was Bulk Furqan. It is the book that I have revealed to make sure that you people, when you are deciding about what is right from what is wrong, what is correct from what is incorrect in religion, the Quran is Al-Furqan, the ultimate criterion. This should decide matters, nothing else. Again, the Almighty knew that people are going to come up with other sources. This source, that source. Only this morning I had to debate with some people who were saying scholars, they tell Islam very clearly. Okay, thank you very much for telling me. So it is the Quran. Scholars have to quote from the Quran. They are nobody without the Quran. It is the Quran which is the ultimate guidance. So the Almighty says that this month is the month of the Quran, and that is why he has asked you to fast. But the question still remains unanswered. You know, it's very interesting that sometimes if you were to ask somebody a question, like you ask me a question, I give you an answer. The answer will have wisdom, but it will have nothing to do with your question. And many a time it so happens that people get lost. Oh, mashallah, you know, it's a very good answer. But by the way, this was not the question. So, you know, the question is that, okay, the Quran is a great book, but what does it have to do with fasting in the month when the Quran was revealed, right? The question still remains. So I'm saying it so that, you know, we do develop this habit of clear thinking, because I'm telling you that it is confused thinking that leads to problems. And when religious people come up with confused thinking, problems are serious. So we must continue to think and ponder and talk to each other about matters where we are in disagreement. There are two things that come to one's mind as to why fasting in Ramadan and the Quran that was revealed in this month are related. The first thing is that the Quran mentions that it's the Hudal Linnas, it's the book of guidance for humans. But is it for all humans? No, it's for Muttaqeen. Hudal Lil Muttaqeen. So it's a book of guidance for those who are God conscious. In other words, if you are a good human, it's only then that you will deserve to be guided. If as yet you are not a good human, work upon your non-goodness, evilness, to become good. And that is why I keep saying this to people, to myself and people in this country, in this society, Muslims, that you know what? The Quran tells us that this book is the book of guidance for the entire humanity, and good people are going to be guided by this book. And there are many good people here in this country, in this society, who are not Muslims. But they deserve it. So, the one thing that the Quran, if it is to properly guide you, properly, you know, you actually become attached to the Quran and you seek guidance from the Quran. You read it over and over again. It's not easy, but it's important. You know, in patches in your life, you might sometimes be inclined to read the Quran and then you give up at some other point. You are attracted by many other things, activities, which cause you to not be interested in the Quran quite as much as it deserves. So in order for it to become a real book of guidance, we need to have taqwa, and taqwa comes from, quite apart from other things, about other ways, from fasting. So that's one relationship. So the relationship is that the Quran was revealed in the month of Ramadan. And therefore, Allah asked believers to fast during the month of Ramadan, and as a result, be able to have within them taqwa. That in turn is going to enable them to be guided by the Quran. It's a bit long mathematical equation, but the equation is there, right? So that's one reason. The other reason is what the Almighty Himself has mentioned, and that is towards the end of verse 185. لِتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا حَدَاكُمْ so that you glorify Allah on the way He has guided you. That again really needs to be explained. And the explanation that I have understood and makes a lot of sense is that when you are fasting, you are hungry and thirsty. It's written on your face. It's something that people can see. If there are some people who are not fasting, maybe some non-Muslims who would ask you, brother, what has happened to you? You're not looking the same. You know, you say I'm fasting. That is, it is my creator, God's expectation from me that the food and the drinks that He has given me to consume without any hesitation, otherwise He has stopped me from consuming. And that is what means that I am declaring that He is the greatest. So I'm glorifying Allah. And He wants it to happen. And that in turn, again, is obviously needed so that we are interested in reading the Quran properly. Because it is the Quran that needs to be understood, and you know, it needs to be emphasized over and over again that by fasting, we become God conscious. We get guided by the Quran. The Quran was revealed in the month of Ramadan. And Allah wants us to glorify Him. And from our existence, from our attitude, conduct, behavior, we say Allah is the greatest. Because if He says that, even if you are hungry and thirsty, don't eat and don't drink. And I'm saying, done. Yes, sir. That's what I'm going to do. So that is what the spirit of it is. So that again is something which is a very important aspect of the month of Ramadan. There are other things that also need to be pointed out, and I'm going to talk about them next time. But the last thing that I would mention here is that there is another aspect of fasting. Very obvious is sabr, patience. The Quran tells us that people who are going to be declared eligible for the paradise are going to be the ones who will have practiced patience, steadfastness. The Quran says in Surah Al-Furqan, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ يُجْزَوْنَ الْغُرْفَةَ بِمَا صَبَرُوا. Those are the people who are going to be rewarded with high mentions of the paradise because they were patient, they were steadfast. This life is a life of trial, and in this life, there are difficulties, there are temptations. And if a person is steadfast and patient, and if a person is patient, steadfast, and is fighting with these odds, difficulties, it's only then that he will be successful. Obviously, when we are fasting, we do have within us this attribute of sabr, of steadfastness, of patience that gets stronger. And that is what should continue to remain. You know, in a hadith, it is mentioned, as-sawmun junna. Fasting is like a defense, you know, when you're fighting with a sword and you have this shield. Fasting is your shield. Anybody who attacks you, you can defend yourself. How? In another hadith, it is said that if somebody tries to pick a fight against you, just say, I'm fasting. I can't fight. I can't return the strong words that you said to me. I'm fasting. So that obviously is an exercise of patience. Honestly, I mean, when you are being patient, you're trying to tell yourself that I am not going to retaliate. I am not going to do the wrong that the other person has done to me. I am not going to react. It doesn't simply come by making a statement. you have to work on it. And obviously, one important occasion is the month of Ramadan when we fast, and it enables us to become patient. It's so unfortunate that there are many people, because they don't realize what they're doing in fasting, exactly while they are fasting, they're impatient, they lose their temper, and therefore they just destroy the very spirit of what they're doing. Taqwa is also based on patience. I mean, you are God conscious, and therefore you are practicing. You are leading your life in accordance with the expectations of the Almighty because you are patient. Because you, in other words, you have control over yourself. You know, a person who is a sabir person is a person who has control over himself. A person who is not a sabir person, his desires, his temper has the better of him. He can't control it. So, I mean, the month of Ramadan is a tremendous opportunity for this extremely important attribute, which, as I said, is going to lead individuals to the paradise to be developed, inculcated. Taqwa and sabr, there's a hadith where your Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that if a person, while fasting, if you're not God conscious, if you're not stopping yourself from doing things which are wrong, which you are expected to do even outside Ramadan, while you are staying hungry and thirsty because of your Creator, you're still telling lies and causing harm to others, which was something that was, always disallowed, prohibited, but you were doing them. And yet you are going through the exercise of becoming God conscious and patient. May the Almighty enable us to understand His religion properly and to enable us to follow it to the best of our abilities.